Thank you very much. Question, is anybody here from Slough or Reading? Any hands, Slough or Reading? Good, excellent. I cut my teeth back in 1989, and I joined Smith Klein Beecham as in a management training program. I did 6 months in marketing, 6 months in business development, and then 9 months as a sales rep. And my patch was Slough and Reading. I drove out the M4, learned to love a great curry. And anyway, after nearly 10 years at Smith Klein Beecham, I spent some time in Novartis as well. And then in 2001, I joined the wild and woolly world of small biotech companies. And I have been at several I've taken public, several that I've sold. One of the more recent ones is a company called Intercept Pharmaceuticals, which is a $4 billion market cap company. I was at one of these events a few weeks ago, and the audience wasn't so biotech focused. It was, I'd say, about 70% were really looking for sales and profits, and there were another 30% that understood that biotech is a longer proposition, it's an investment. And that's what we are. We are a development stage company. As Sarah mentioned, we have a couple products in development that will be in phase two. It's been a pretty dramatic turnaround or transformation over the past 24 months. I'm going to walk through a little bit of data today on why I think it's an interesting proposition, why I think it's a good value proposition. You had mentioned earlier some of the companies that Neil Woodford had invested in, most of the companies. Invesco is our largest owner, and when Neil was there, I think this was one of his pieces, so there is a little bit of a theme here. Anyway, as I look at companies, or as one would look at companies to invest in the therapeutic space, the three things I would look at to understand would be, one, is there a mechanism of action or reason to believe why this should work? Number two, does it look like it works or is safe in animals? And number three, is there any human data? I'm going to show you some on all three of those today because I think we have a very exciting story. We are public, listed on AIM. We went public about 10 years ago, and the company, as Sarah mentioned, was doing several different things. When I was brought in 2 years ago, the task was focused down, sell off any non-strategic businesses, and turn it into a drug development company. I think we are at, as I said recently, the end of the beginning. We have a very solid team. I'm pleased that my chief financial officer, chief operating officer, Marella Thorell, is here in the audience. Our chief medical officer will be joining me later this afternoon. He's a special hire because he came about almost a year ago. He's an immunologist, and he had just sold his company, as chief medical officer for $1.2 billion in the U.S., so he had opportunities to do what he wanted. He was surveying lots of different technologies. Did he want to work? What did he want to do? He found our data incredibly compelling as an immunologist, and therefore we're extremely lucky to have him join us. What is Realm? Realm went public, as I mentioned, 10 years ago. Sarah, you correctly pronounced hypochlorous acid, which took me a few weeks to say correctly. Hypochlorous acid is something your body makes. It's natural. A way that I think about it is, at very low concentrations of hypochlorous acid, it's actually in your drinking water. At around 4 parts per million, it's in your drinking water, so it's natural, it's organic. At around 50 parts per million, we were selling a wash that kills bugs. It kills bugs, just like your body uses it to fight infection. The neat part of the aha for me was that at higher concentrations, at 100 parts per million, we see other competitors still making hypochlorous acid. But at 200, 400, 500, 1,000 parts per million, hypochlorous acid happens to have very good immunomodulatory effects or anti-inflammatory effects. So when I joined, I thought, let's boil the ocean, if you will. Let's look at what could we do with this technology because we've been able to stabilize it and patent it. Those are the tricky parts. Hypochlorous acid has been around many years. It's not a novel compound per se. What is novel is the fact that higher concentrations do some very interesting things, and we've patented those. So as I have up on the slides here, we have phase two trials that will be beginning this year, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the opportunities in both of those. Before I get started, just to sort of share one chemistry curve, I'm not a scientist, but as you take a low pH, so on the right-hand side of your screen, when you have a low pH, you essentially have chlorine gas. We know that can be bad and noxious. On the right-hand side of your screen, when you have a high pH, it's sodium hypochlorite or bleach. And bleach is not something you would use as a, you know, in your eyes, in your mouth, on your skin. That sweet spot right in the middle is hypochlorous acid between 4.5 and 6.5 pH. And the challenge for years has been stabilizing hypochlorous acid, which is what we have been able to do and patent it. So we have a patented solution, which is a granted formulation patent around the ability to stabilize patents and then the ability to use hypochlorous acid for these interesting conditions, which I will talk to you about in a minute. Every biotech company or every therapeutic company puts up a pipeline chart. This is our chart today. We have a lot more, and I have something I can talk to in a bit that we can do, but I'm trying to be focused with the limited cash that we have. Some of the cash that we took from selling off the previous businesses, so I have cash now today to get me through two phase two clinical trials. First IND, we announced that we filed it January 31st, and for those of you who know the timelines of FDA, when you file an IND, you then have a 30-day window to parry back and forth and answer any questions, and we've been in that process right now. So fingers crossed, next week, if things go well, we should be able to announce that we're not on clinical hold, that we're able to go through and into our first clinical trial. One of the reasons this is interesting is because in typical drug development, if you look at most disease states, you need to go preclinical, into phase one, into phase two, and it's a longer time frame. Because hypochlorous acid is known, and because we have some data which I'll share, the FDA is allowing us to bypass that phase one and go directly into phase two in both these indications. Anybody heard of the company called Anacor? Good. Okay, so Anacor is a company I had not heard of. The reason I like a company called Anacor is because Anacor had a product in phase three for atopic dermatitis. And Anacor was bought by Pfizer last year for $5.2 billion. $5.2 billion for a product that wasn't on the market yet. It's still not on the market yet. It was just approved in December and probably be launching in the next quarter or so. We think we have a product that could be superior to Anacor's. Crisabrol is the generic name, or Eucrisa is the branded name. Pfizer bought it, and Pfizer thinks that this product from Anacor is going to be a $2 billion in sales product. We haven't released our projections, what we think ours is going to do, but we think we have a blockbuster on our hands. So that's Pfizer's Anacor back in May. I'm guessing if you hadn't heard of Anacor, you probably hadn't heard of Ziarco either. Ziarco is, or was, a private biotech company in the UK. And if you think of atopic dermatitis, which is an umbrella term for eczema, the itchy eczema, the redness, Ziarco has a product that doesn't treat the eczema, but if you take the pill, it treats the itch associated with eczema, and it had a product in phase two, and Novartis bought Ziarco for reportedly $1 billion last year. A private company, a phase two trial, just the itch associated with asthma. And then finally, Allergan buys a company called Vitae. Vitae is about 3 miles away from us in the States. We're based in Pennsylvania. And Vitae had a program in phase two. This program hadn't even reported out. So the phase two data was in the middle of their trial, around the same size trial that we're going to run. Allergan swooped in and bought them for $639 million. Unfortunately for Allergan, 2 months later, the trial didn't work. But Vitae at least is happy that they were able to build the product to a certain point. And my message or take home here is that this, i.e. dermatology, is a much hotter, sexier, interesting space than it certainly was 5 years ago. If I think about hypochlorous acid, is that a novel chemical entity? Not necessarily. But the $5 billion deal that Pfizer did for Anacor's product, Anacor had a boron-based product. Borons, again, nothing novel in boron. They had tweaked the molecule and had some formulation patents. So there's some similarities there. And I could go on with other comparables. There's a company called Aclaris, which is a billion-dollar company in the States that has phase two programs, phase two, phase three, in dermatology. Hot field right now. So now let me talk to you about the data, how we have mechanism of action data. Someone mentioned that this morning. Why should it work? And then a little bit about the animal data and a little about the human data. This is just a couple pictures on what eczema can be. It's not just sort of a little dry skin. It can be pretty nasty and significant impact on quality of life. There are people who have committed suicide after the scratching bout. So it's a big problem. It mainly affects children. So if you think about diseases that affect children, what do you want? You certainly want something that's safe. You probably want to stay away from needles. And that's where our product could certainly fall in nicely. Today, if you were to ask doctors, how are you treating eczema or atopic dermatitis? The standard answer is through corticosteroids, these corticosteroid creams. And if you put these on your hands or a little child's hands, they can't touch their faces, they can't touch their eyes. It's a tricky proposition for them. There are also products called calcineurin inhibitors. Novartis had a big one. There's a product called Elidel. These have what's called a black box warning on them, meaning they could cause cancer. Suffice to say, there is a sort of screaming market need, which is why big drug companies are paying big dollars for companies that have potential treatments for asthma. It's important to look at how we stack up versus these therapies, but it's also important to look at how we stack up what's in the current pipeline of products. The two bolded products are the ones that analysts are speaking about the most, the top one being Anacor's product that I just mentioned, and it is recently approved. The second one that's bolded towards the bottom, the Sanofi Regeneron product, they have an injectable monoclonal antibody. The reason this is important is because of two reasons. One, it works really well, especially in the severe cases, so you inject a person and it works very well. Challenge is, it is a monoclonal antibody, and I can guarantee you a five-year-old or a parent of a five-year-old who comes in and has a choice between an injectable or a cream may try the cream first, especially if they think they're doing the same thing. And that, to me, is the crowning piece here. Sanofi is out there advertising in JAMA, in some of the big journals, that their product is an IL-4, IL-13 agonist. I'm not a scientist, but I can understand there's IL-4, IL-13, and they're promoting the role of IL-4, IL-13 in eczema. The good news is our product, our gel, have an IL-4, IL-13 agonist. So when you put this gel on, it also downregulates IL-4, IL-13. So we have this big company advertising what a great thing it is to do to downregulate these key cytokines in the inflammatory pathway, and then we can come along and say, that's great. For those severe patients who need the injectable, that's wonderful. And incidentally, Sanofi will be charging $10,000 to $20,000 per course treatment, and we're probably going to be in the more $500 price range. And I heard someone talk about reimbursement earlier this morning. And at $500, you're still under that threshold of really setting off alarm bells for reimbursement. Incidentally, $500 is probably what Pfizer is going to be charging for their $2 billion drug, the one they just bought. So very exciting time to be in this space, and glad that I think we have a nice opportunity, specifically on the mechanism of action or why we think it should work. Remember, I said three reasons to look at. One would be the mechanism of action, second is preclinical data, and the third is human data. This is the preclinical data. So what you do here is you take some dust mite, some house dust mite, crush it up into a gel, and you smear it onto the animal. And the animal, guess what, develops these lesions that are sort of akin to a rash or something that would look like atopic dermatitis. It's a standard model used regularly. What happens when you use our gel, it's a non-alcohol-based hydrogel, when you use that in conjunction with this house dust mite, the animals don't develop the lesions. So that's great that we can prevent the disease. More importantly for me is, can we treat the disease? Because prevention is a tricky market. So the first thing I did when I came on board was, let's run some prevention, some treatment models. We did that, and here's the first treatment model. The top line shows how the scores keep getting worse if you just treat the animal, but if you treat them with either a steroid, which we know works, or if you treat it with our product, you see they both help improve lesion scores and can treat the models. We ran this again with a third type of product called a JAK inhibitor, which is a molecule that's being used to treat inflammation. Similar results I can share with you if anybody's interested. So we talked about mechanism of action, preclinical. This is the human data. To get to the human data, it's more, I have to again share part of the story. Over the past 10 years, we have been stabilizing and using hypochlorous acid in many different ways. One of the things the company did was they got an approval with the FDA via a 510K, which is sort of an easier path to approval, for a device, for a lower concentration. So while we're running our studies now, the clinical studies will be probably in the 500, 750, 850, 1,000, in that range. The study that we had a product that's approved by FDA for 450 parts per million. So that's 450 parts per million product that's approved by FDA. This is a technicality. It's not approved as a drug. It's approved as a medical device, which means you don't get reimbursement, which means you don't have the same data, which means dermatologists sort of sniff their nose at a little bit. They think, oh, this is a little bit like a barrier cream. This will be a $30 million product as opposed to a $1 billion product like Crisabrol because it's not a drug. We had this product, this 450 parts per million product that was approved, being prescribed by physicians. We had licensed it to a small company. They were swallowed up by Valiant. We took the product back, and now we have that product, so it's approved. And the good news is, because it was approved, we've had patients use it. Brian Berman is on the American Academy of Pediatrics, and he ran a study, Academy of Dermatology, he ran a study on itch. Remember I told you Ziarko had a pill for itch? So he ran a study showing what does this do in itch. The results are pretty significant, that at 74% of patients who used our lotion didn't have the itch associated with atopic dermatitis. And 70% of those on the other side of the chart, on the right-hand side, it got worse if you weren't using it. So again, this is not a kind of trial that we would be submitting for the FDA for our registration, but it's enough data that helped the FDA get comfortable and allow us to jump directly into phase two. The conclusions of this trial were that it was effectively reducing pruritus or itch as early as day one, and certainly by day three, it was well tolerated and no serious adverse events reported. So to me, this is a fantastic sort of, we've got mechanism of action, preclinical data, some human data, some great comparables out there. The market's screaming for other products or other companies like this. Very, very happy that we have atopic dermatitis here. That's the atopic dermatitis story, and I'll give a much more brief story on allergic conjunctivitis, which is our other indication. Quick next steps on atopic dermatitis. We did file the IND a few weeks ago. We're waiting to hear. And then we'll be starting that clinical trial this year. So we have an excellent group of clinicians who are helping us, the people who all worked on the Sanofi product and the people who worked on the Crisabrol, the Anacor product. They're now advisors of ours. They like what we're doing. And we have people talking to them when they're under diligence, talking to those advisors about, oh, could be interesting. Why do you think this could be better? So we have a great team working on this. And I'm very, very pleased and excited about it. That's the dermatitis story. Allergic conjunctivitis. Even more straightforward, it's the itchy eyes or redness when you get pollen. You probably know what it is. There are many cousins to this disease. There's infectious conjunctivitis. We've chosen to look specifically at allergic conjunctivitis. One of the reasons I like allergic conjunctivitis, even though it's a smaller market, it's treated either with steroids or antihistamines. The largest antihistamine franchise does about $400 million. So for us to compete, we need to be certainly, you know, better than antihistamines or comparable to steroids. That was the test that we wanted to do, which we ran, and I have the data right here. So I like the data, obviously, but I even more like the model because I'll tell you what that represents for humans. The data I like, the gray bar right here, is just if you irritate, you put basically ragweed in the eye, you'll see that saline doesn't do anything. Ocular redness stays very red. The blue bar is what happens if you use a competitor, someone who's doing 100 parts per million. Now remember, anybody who's doing 100 parts per million can't do it higher because they either technically can't make it higher, or they can't stabilize it, or they run into our patent. So the best competitor is not going to have an effect at reducing redness. The red bar in the middle is one of our higher concentrations, and it compares very favorably to both steroids and antihistamines. It looks actually better than antihistamines and comparable to steroids. So this is good data showing that it works, but a lot of times mouse or animal models don't translate into human. That's a concern. This model is the exact same model that you would use in humans. So for the clinical trial, which we're going to be starting this year, for the clinical trial, you take patients who show up to the doctor's office knowing that they're going to get ragweed spray in their eyes, and then you clear it up. And it's only a 14-day trial, so it's quick to recruit, it's quick to find the results. And again, we've seen it work here, so it's to me, that's a de-risked option for us. Those are the two things we're looking to do this year. The path forward is straightforward. We'll be filing this IND in the third quarter. We're still on track for that. And don't anticipate any issues to moving into a clinical trial shortly thereafter.
1 minute left.
Got it, thank you. It's a good time to close then. So I put up that little chart that said atopic dermatitis and allergic conjunctivitis. Those are the two trials that we can afford to do right now with the cash that we have. There are many other, I'll call them cousin or kindred indications that we could use. Acne, for example, I have used it. My kid, my 16-year-old has used it. My chief medical officer has used the 450, the slightly lower concentration. But because we know this has an antimicrobial and anti-inflammatory component, one would think it could and should, and it does work for acne. So there are opportunities beyond the two that I've outlined today. Quick financials, the last reported number was around $24 million. As of October, we have closer to 20 or so now. It'll take us through these two clinical trials. I mentioned Invesco is the largest shareholder. I'm trying to make my time. And these are our key upcoming milestones. We have other things where we'll be presenting and doing things, but the key things that you should be on the lookout for would be, one, a press release in the near term saying that we can go forward. So once we've finalized discussions with the FDA, we should be able to announce, here it is, give some guidance on timings. We'll probably talk a little bit about sales size, and then throughout the rest of the year, we'll be filing the IND, as I mentioned, and getting two more clinical trials up and running. That's it. Thank you for your time, and I'm around to answer questions.
Great. Thank you. Well done for leapfrogging straight to phase two and for stabilizing the pH and for getting Sanofi to do your marketing for you.
Thank you.
That's that was quite a coup. There have already been predictions by analysts when these your two flagship treatments are to be launched. And it's quite soon, according to some analysts, for the AD, 2021, and for the conjunctivitis, 2020. Is this possible?
So it is possible. I come from non-derm and non-ophthalmology. I come from sort of other small molecules, which could take 10 years. So let me speak specifically about allergic conjunctivitis. Allergic conjunctivitis, if the data is the same in humans, that is in my, that we saw in preclinical, all you need to do is show a 25% reduction. Remember there was that score that had 4, 3, 2, 1. If you show a difference, a change in redness from 4 to 3, 3 to 2, or 2 to 1, that phase 2B trial can be counted as a phase 3. So in theory, we could be starting a trial that could be one of our phase 3 trials if you get a 25% reduction. So yes, that could be a potential.
Okay, what about the relationship we have with the FDA? I've never heard of people leapfrogging phases.
So it was a surprise to us. It was definitely the plan, but I have to lay that at the hands of our chief medical officer, who is an immunologist and understands immunology, and to sort of pitch, here's why the body of evidence shows that this is safe. And again, we have to hear next week, we have to hear that, you know, we're sort of through through FDA, but assuming that goes well, then...
You're pretty confident that that's going to happen.
Yes.
Okay, question.
Assuming these two studies are successful, would you plan to launch these RX or OTC? And in either of those scenarios, would you do it on your own or with a partner?
Excellent question.
So OTC being over the counter.
Yes. So would I launch them RX or over the counter? Absolutely, RX is number one. There's a better price and there's just better market potential. The product that we had on the market, this 450 lower solution, we were selling for a gross price of $300 a tube. So we know that we can command that as a prescription. And so the first question was, and will we do it ourselves? So I know I had a nice slide on here talking about all the acquisitions. I've done this before. You have to build a company as if you're going to be there and get there and be there 5 years out. And so that's what we're doing. We're putting together a plan, the team, the money to get us 5 years out. Do I think it's realistic that we will ultimately sell this on our own? Realistic's the wrong word. Do I think it's likely? I think it's more likely that we would get taken out. So.
Well, that's the trend, isn't
right,
it? As
right.
you've demonstrated
right.
with all the other deals that you discussed.
Right.
Okay, so that's another one of my questions out of the way. Yes, please.
Hello, yes. Interesting that you've got a novel therapeutic use for what is actually a pretty commonplace molecule. My question is that hypohalites are pretty unstable, so I'm assuming that the shelf life of your product is fairly limited. And do you have a strategy for dealing with that limited shelf life?
We do. So excellent question. Again, the big challenges are stabilizing it and getting the shelf life. We have a product at a lower concentration that we sold off this division, which had 24 months stability, 24 months shelf life. We have some buffers that we've put into it. So you hit on the head the challenge that other people have had. How do you keep it stable? And we believe that with the buffers that we have and the sort of special sauce, the formulation, it allows it to do that.
Very good. Any more questions? Yes.
Thank you. I saw psoriasis was on your list of indications, and psoriasis, big market, growing market, used to use of biologics where they're already extensively used. Would that not be a more natural place for your product?
One of picking the indication, the first indications, was probably one of the most difficult things we had to do, and it wasn't just me. We brought in some consultants who do this for big pharma, and they looked at 400 different indications. And so the two that came up to the top where they said, highest likelihood of success, quickest route to market, least expensive, clinical trials are limited, are going to be these two. Fast followers, if you had a little more money, psoriasis is right up there. So we are running, we're not talking about, we are running some preclinical models in a lot of, in some of these other areas, and could certainly be an opportunity.
Yes, hello. There is a rumor out there in the UK GP land that a spoonful of bleach inside a bath is very effective for this condition.
That's a very good rumor, and there's some truth to it, too. So a couple of things we're doing right now. So first off, it's called a bleach bath. Right? And a bleach bath is something that GPs and dermatologists have at times recommended and can be effective, absolutely. A few notes of caution. I didn't put up some pictures of people who have, unfortunately, put the wrong amount of bleach in. Horrific burns. So I view it as it certainly can work. We're in the middle of identifying the difference between hypochlorite and hypochlorous acid. We've shown that 50 parts per million of hypochlorite doesn't work the way 500 ppm of hypochlorous does. But you're right. Bleach baths can work with the caveats.
Okay, final question.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Are your products off-the-counter or must have a GP prescription?
So the product that we had approved, we had it approved and it was being written as a prescription, and we plan on launching these as prescription products.
Essentially in the US first.
Well, we would like to, we have rights for them worldwide, and our limited finances today are running the trials in the US, but we absolutely have plans for Europe, Japan, and the rest of the world.
I do think that your time in Slough and Reading shaped and defined you, because you were introduced to curries there, and a lot
yes.
of the spices
yes.
in the curries are anti-inflammatory.
Absolutely.
Just saying.
Absolutely. Yep. No, I'm a fan.
Alex, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
That's great.
Thank you.